Student, today we are going to discuss immunoelectrophoresis. So we will start with some introduction, like what is antigen, what is antibody, how the antigen-antibody reaction takes place. So in immunology, an antigen is a molecule capable of inducing an immune response on the part of the host organism. Though sometimes antigen can be part of the host itself, that means we can consider some of the host own protein can act as an antigen. That is, sometimes you must have heard that autoimmune disease. In other words, an antigen is any substance that causes an immune system to produce antibodies against it. Now you must also heard that antigen, there are some epitopes after processing, these are called antigenic determinants, against what the specific antibody production takes place. Now, what are the antibodies? Antibodies are protein which are highly evolved for specific recognition of immunological determinants called antigen. Immunological determinants, we call them epitopes. The principal source of antibody are either experimental animal like rabbits or mouse hybridoma cells. These are all where we are getting in the laboratory. When immunodetection is combined with electrophoretic separation of protein, these techniques we called immunoelectrophoresis. Now here what we will be seeing, that antigen-antibody reaction, they sometimes produce precipitation. So that we are detecting with the help of electrophoresis. So the technique's name here, immunoelectrophoresis. Little bit in detail. So this is a typical structure of IgG. This is an antibody molecule. The two arms of this Y-shaped antibody, what we are showing in the diagram, these are the variable region. The other part, the long part, is we call constant region, Fc region. Now this is an antigen. After processing, it actually displays many epitopes. As I already mentioned, these are the antigenic determinants. Now against which these epitopes, different antibodies recognize different epitopes. So this is actually antigen antibody reaction takes place, and this is one laboratory based technique how we are going to detect the antigen antibody. So what we are doing here, blotting technique. So in a nitrocellulose membrane, you are taking an antigen at a drop. So it could be a blood, it could be some other antigenic protein. So now what we are doing, we are covered with some known protein to avoid any non-specific interaction. Then we are incubating with the antibody, specific antibody, anti-rabbit IgG, horseradish peroxidase. B is, we are discussing only the primary antibody we have added. So again I repeat, I have taken the antigen and the nitrocellulose membrane. I applied BSA in order to reduce the any non-specific interaction. Then I charge with a specific antibody. So what we are expecting, there is an antigen-antibody complex formation takes place. Next is what we are doing. We are using secondary antibody, that is anti-antibody. So we have used IgG. Now we are using the secondary antibody, that is anti-rabbit IgG, which is tagged with some enzyme. So what is an enzyme? Horseradish peroxidase conjugate. So that's the secondary antibody is tagged with an enzyme. Now if we give the substrate for the specific enzyme, it can produce and color. It will change the substrate to the product, and the product may be a colored one, which can be visualized by giving the substrate, and we can visualize naked eyes also. So we can estimate, if we are taking different amount of different concentration of antigen, we can also interpret the by seeing the color change. We can the quantitization also we can perform. This is a dot blot experiment. Now there are many methods whereby we can measure the precipitation by different method. One such method is light scattering. Antigen antibody complexes, when formed at a high rate, will precipitate out of a solution, resulting a turbid or cloudy appearance. Now there is another branch of science which we call turbidometry, that measure the turbidity or cloudiness of a solution by measuring amount of light directly passing through a solution. And there is another technology branch of science that we named as nephelometry, indirect measurement. It measures the amount of light scattered by the antigen-antibody complex. So one is the amount of scattered light we are measuring. One is the measurement how much light is passing through the turbid solution. That measurement you can do. By measuring that, we can quantitize how much the precipitation reaction takes place. Now, generally in the laboratory, the basic things what we do, these are all belongs to a passive immunodiffusion assay. So what we call that antigen and antibody, actually we allow them to react in agar gel. So they diffuse. So antigen from the slot, it will diffuse to other side, and the antibody will diffuse. And they meet in optimal proportion, form a precipitate. So that is the thing where the precipitation takes place that we can see in naked eye. Now, this is passive diffusion. Why we say? Because they are allowed to react to completion with no enhancement such as an electrical charge applied. So here we are allowing them to diffuse by their own way. We are not doing anything extra, separation technique we are not using here. That's why we are telling it passive immunodiffusion. Now, factors which are affecting the rate of diffusion, size of the particle, that definitely affect the rate of diffusion, temperature, gel viscosity and hydration, interaction of reactants with the gel. Generally, agarose gel, what we use, they are very inert. They should not interact with your antigen and antibody, but that also need to be, you should consider that factor also. Now, here comes some of this kind of precipitation reaction of antigen antibody, and with the help of diffusion technology, how we people have identified, we will discuss. One such method is Octolini identity. Octolini physicist, a Swedish physicist who discovered this precipitation reaction and observed this typical pattern formation. Now let us see what are these pattern, and the precipitation appears as a continuous line in the form of an arc between the two outer well and the center well. There are no spurs at the angle, and this type of reaction is termed a band of identity. Now let me explain what is this. We have actually poured the agarose gel on a slide or any tray also you can cast it. So what we have done, we have made three holes. So you see two holes are there and one hole just in a down. So it's an angular formation, a triangle you can imagine. Okay, so the upper two are the two antigen you have taken. The same antigen you have taken, one and two hole. We have added same antigen. Let's say the antigen is X. Now in the third well, what we are adding? We are adding an antibody of that particular antigen X. So anti-X is there. So what we expect, it will diffuse towards this side. This antigen also diffused, and they will form a typical this kind of pattern. Now if it is only visible if X is present in one and two, that means both the well, the same antigen is present, and the specific antibody of that antigen we have kept in the third well, then only this kind of pattern you will visualize. Now, Octolini partial identity. What is the meaning of partial identity? See this picture first. Again, in the third well, we are keeping the antibody, and in the well number one and two, we are keeping the antigen. Only difference here, we are keeping in one two antigen XY and in other only X. So these are partially identical, which is common of them. X antigen is common. It is present both in one and two. But which is uncommon? Y. There is no Y antigen in two well. But antibody is there in three well. Both the antibodies, antibody against X, antibody against Y, both are present in well number three. Now, if a solution with antigen X and Y is placed in well 1, a solution with antigen X only is placed in well 2, and anti serum containing antibody specific for both X and Y is placed in well 3, a reaction similar to that appearing in figure 2, which we have discussed, will occur. Notice that there is a spot reaction towards XY well. This indicates that the two antigenic materials in well 1 and 2 are related, but that the material in well 1 possesses an antigenic specificity not possessed by the material in well 2. Such a reaction with spar formation indicates partial identity. That's what you will see the inside this one. This pattern, it is not a complete arc. There is a spore is there. That indicates that these are partially identity. So these two wells are not containing exactly same antigen. Yes, they are identical. That means one is common, but in other one, something extra is there, which is not present in the well number 2. Now, out after only non-identity, what will happen? If the material in well 1 and 2 do not possess common antigen and the antiserum in well 3 possesses specificities for both the materials, the reaction will appear as two crossed lines as shown in this figure. So what is the matter? The number in well 1 and well 2, two different antigens are present. In well 3, we have antibody against both of them, but none of them are identical. So what we are expecting? We are expecting two lines of this, it will also diffuse, this will also diffuse, and they will cross each other. This particular pattern of actually indicates its non-identity. The next what we are going to, this is we are going to discuss, that is we named as rocket immunoelectrophoresis. This is not a passive electrophoresis as we passive immunodiffusion, because here we are applying an electrophoresis a technique. It is adaptation of radial immunodiffusion. Antibody incorporated, actually mixed with the gel. Antigen added to well. Now, what is actually thing I will discuss? Apply electric current and antigen will move forward and will bind to the antibody. Dissolution and reformation occurs. Height of the precipitin band related to concentration of antigen, it is much faster than radial immunodiffusion. So let us see the picture and we can discuss this thing. So this is we are casting an agarose gel on a slide or in a, inside a tray. So and we are what we are doing, we are making some well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 well we are showing in a blue color. So we are giving antigen, we are putting antigen here. And the pH of the gel we are keeping 8.6 negative. So all the proteins are hopefully will be negatively charged. Now, when we are preparing the agarose gel, the antibodies specific for this antigen we are adding already here with the gel. So gel itself contains the antibody. Okay. Now once we start, then we are putting inside the electrophoresis apparatus and covered with buffer and turn on the electricity. What we are seeing, so we are allowing the antigen to run from negative to positive because it is negatively charged. Okay, so once it will move, as the antibody is already present inside, where inside the gel, so it will interact with antibody based on the concentration. It will move. Okay, how much is there increasing the antigenic concentration? I have showing here more antigen will be there. It will move more towards the positive electrode, and it will make a particular precipitin arcs which looks like rockets. So that's why it's named as rocket immunoelectrophoresis. So antigen is electrophoresed into gel containing antibody. Remember this word. The distance from the starting well to the front of the rocket shaped arc is related to antigen concentration. So this is a typical rocket electrophoresis pattern. Once if you already performed, you will have definitely observed this kind of pattern you will observe in the gel. Next is our zone electrophoresis. What is zone electrophoresis? This is also we are casting agarose gel on a slide or tray. and we are keeping making a hole in the corner of the plate, in one corner, and we are adding the antigen there, and we are making another small trough towards the longitudinal length, longitudinal side of the slide. Okay, so this is a trough. You cut it, and you are allowing the antigen to run. So antigen is pH you have to adjust so that it will be negatively charged, so it will move from negative to positive. So again I repeat, so you have prepared a thin gel on a slide or on a plate. So what you are doing after that, you make a hole and there you are loading your antigen. So the pH condition of the gel is buffer is such a way so that it is negatively charged and it will run from negative to positive end. And you have already another thing I've done at the longitudinal side, you have cut another trough. So once the electrophoresis is done, you are expecting the proteins what are present inside that antigen, they will be separated. So these are separated. Okay, once they are separated, then you are adding the antibody in the trough. This horizontally cut that trough, you have already cut it here, and you are adding now antibody. Now allow them to diffuse. Now here you are not doing any electrophoresis you have done in this step. So you have added the antigen, you have allowed them to run. So after the run is done, even though you are not able to see the separation, but you are expecting this is the way the protein will be separated, then you are adding the antibody in the trough and allowing for one day to diffuse. So what is the principle? The antibody will diffuse this side, antigen will diffuse that side, and after one overnight you may see if there is a common antigen antibody specific for that, it will form a precipitation line like this. Okay, so this is another electrophoresis. It is we call counter immunoelectrophoresis. It is little bit different from the one which I have just described. Here in the you have casted a gel on a thin slide or a tray, and you are making two well, one in one corner, one end, another one is in another end. So the agarose gel pH is 8.6, so all are negatively charged. We are expecting all the antigen. Okay, so what we are doing here, antigens in a gel medium in which the pH is controlled are strongly negatively charged and will migrate rapidly across the electric field towards the anode. The antibody in such a medium is less negatively charged and will migrate in an opposite or counter direction towards the cathode. If the antigen and antibody are specific for each other, they combine and form a distinct precipitin line. It was used for the rapid diagnosis of some bacterial, mycoplasma and viral infection. So what we are actually discussing, we are taking a same slide or tray where we have casted agarose gel, and the buffer is the way it is maintained that the antigen is fully negative. It should be, all the protein should be negatively charged, so it will move from negative to positive side. But at this pH, the specific antibody we have, it's known antibody, should not be that much negative. So there is a chance that it will move from the other side. So if they interact during the precipitation area, it will form a line. So this is actually the picture. These techniques earlier people used to use to detect the some of the viral infection or serum protein, some bacterial infection, mycoplasma. These are the things people used to separate and used to for immunological diagnosis purpose. There was earlier time people used to use this kind of techniques, but with the evolution of so many new techniques have come, like ELISA, which I discussed, a dot blood technique there, and much more faster, much more robust, and giving a very conclusive result within a limited time. So these techniques are not so much popular nowadays, but they have definitely some of the impact in our to understand the immunology, the antibody antigen reaction. Okay, thank you very much.